Hello and welcome to Art House, a Flatland conversation about all things art in cinema. My name is John McGrath. I'm a producer for Flatland at Kansas City PBS. And guess what? I'm also a filmmaker. My first guest is Erin-Hamer Bec. She's a professor at the University of Missouri, Kansas City, where she teaches film classes. She's also does some lecturing at the Kansas City Art Institute. And she's an English professor at Metropolitan Community College in Longview. Geez, Erin, did I get all that right?
Yeah. I also teach screenwriting at Rockhurst, so I'm busy. I've got good tires.
My next guest is Emily Woodring. Emily, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
Emily is our food content producer for Flatland at Kansas City PBS. She's also a recent graduate at the University of Missouri, Kansas City, where she got a communications degree with an emphasis in film studies. And I think you may have taken a class from somebody sitting right next to you.
I have, yes.
What class was it? Do you remember?
It was a documentary history class.
And you said you remembered it right away.
Right when I saw her. I was like, I know Emily. And it was a big class, too. It was a big lecture.
Yeah,
class,
it was.
But we won't get into what grade she got.
Okay. I graduated.
Okay, so next let's talk about the format here on Art House. We do three things. Okay, the first thing we do is we have a topic of the show, which we'll get to in just a second. And then after that, we do some new releases. Those can be new releases, not just in theaters, but a new release on Blu-ray or something new on streaming. And then the next is Streamhouse. So Streamhouse in the Art House, trying to be hip and cool here. So we're going to talk about some cool films you can find on all these awesome streaming sites, not just the Netflix and the Amazons and the Hulus, but like the Criterion Collection and Canopy, which is a really awesome way to stream movies through your local library. You can get those if you get a library card, which we're going to talk about later. Okay, so Erin, tell me a little bit more about what you do here locally.
Yeah. Over the fall, I did an entire Girlhood in Cinema series with the Kansas City Public Library Plaza Branch. It was amazing. It was a series of four films. We featured Circumstance by Miriam Keshavarez, which is a beautiful film about, it's a Persian film about two girls that fall in love with each other. It's heartbreaking, painful. We also did Paper Moon, the Bogdanovich film. It was really fun. It was amazing to be able to share these films with the community.
Well, we're so lucky to have you on the show on Art House. Thanks again for being here.
Thank you.
Okay, Emily, so tell me a little bit about Tom Poe and the Tivoli. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yes, Tom Poe was definitely the person who got me into, I guess, art films.
Right.
I had been making some short films before then, but I had never really known a lot of the history, and foreign films were foreign to me, you know, so it was just like an opening of this whole new world. And I took these, they were weekend classes,
right,
you know, during each semester. And we would just be at the Tivoli 9 to 5, Saturday and Sunday, and just watch foreign films or film noir. And, you know, yeah, Tom Poe taught me everything about art films.
Yeah, and unfortunately he's not with us
right
anymore, and he was one of my favorites. I really love Tom. So, but that's so great. So when Emily got here, Erin, she was an intern, and then she moved up to being a producer here. And she's quite the cinephile, and we just totally connected. We talk about The Seventh Seal and, you know, all these great French New Wave, and it's just so awesome to have her, to work with her. It's great. So,
yeah, it's a good foundation. I took a Hitchcock class with Tom Poe. He was a genius. I mean, but he, I think, had forgotten more about film than I'll ever know. It was stunning. It was wonderful to be in his classes.
Yeah, so they were fun.
Yeah, they really
He was
were.
Always excited about everything.
Yeah.
You know?
9 to 5 just went like that.
Yeah.
Like it was over before you even knew it. It was amazing.
Yeah. Tom Poe, he's great.
Yeah.
Okay. So our topic for the show is women filmmakers. Seems kind of broad, but I'm going to break it down into kind of three different categories. Why do we need more female voices in film? What can we do to promote female voices in filmmaking? And also, my little rub is about the Academy Awards. And I think we're almost up to 100 years now, folks, and only 5 women have been nominated for Best Director, and only one has won. So, and then there was a big controversy about Greta Gerwig not getting nominated for Little Women, which I think was not good. I mean, 51% of the population is women.
Yeah.
We need more voices, but there it seems like directing is kind of this more of a male-dominated thing. What can we do about that? What do you think about that?
I mean, you know, it's astonishing, really, when you think about the foundation of cinema and how film language was basically developed by women. And I don't know if the statistic is still true, but it was a couple of years ago, there were fewer women in production roles in cinema than there were in the 1980s. And, you know, I don't know if it's just an environment because, you know, you hear a lot from the Me Too movement and some of the these, you know, Hollywood producers. Maybe women don't want the, you know, want to kind of be in these roles. But I think about like... Princess Leia.
Carrie Fisher.
Carrie Fisher.
Oh, Carrie
Fisher. She was in Star Wars. She said, I looked around and there were all of these men behind the cameras and they were all doing these things. You would occasionally see a girl doing makeup.
Wow.
And it, you know, it was true back then and it's still true. And I think that like the Academy Awards, things like that are sending out a message, hopefully to women to think, you know what, we need to change this. We need to start making movies because we have a voice and it needs to be heard through cinema. So hopefully.
Yeah. Emily, we were talking earlier. Mm-hmm. What do you think about this? And that let's not even just Greta Gerwig. What are some other filmmakers just recently that I think got robbed or whatever?
They got robbed. Well, I think the problem is like, I don't know. I don't know a lot of women filmmakers, you know, like all the names she just said, I don't know who those women are.
Right.
And so they don't get propped up a lot, you know, as some others. They're there. And I know a lot in the beginning of filmmaking and cinema history, there was a lot of women screenwriters. Mm-hmm. That was huge, right?
Yeah, yeah.
In the Hollywood scene. And I don't know who any of them are either.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, so I'd love to give you some names right now, but I didn't do enough research. And yeah, I just can't. Besides, yeah, like Agnes Varda and Greta Gerwig, Sandy Tan, who created Shirkers, you know, mm-hmm. It's like. Off the top of my head, I can't really think.
No, Lulu Wang for The Farewell.
Right. Yeah. I haven't seen that, but that was definitely on my list.
And Melina Matsoukas, who did Queen and Slim. Amazing, beautiful films, completely forgotten and not really talked about in any sort of, you know, mainstream media, which is unfortunate because these are incredible films and they need to be, you know, I think front and center, just like all of the other male-dominated films. So.
Well, that's what we're here to do. Okay, so I want to, the interesting thing, the BFI, the British Film Institute, last year in 2019, they put out their top 100 films directed by a woman. Okay, so I'm just going to give you the top three. And this goes to Emily's point, okay? Number one is The Piano by Jane Campion from 1993. Have you seen The Piano?
I love The Piano.
Have you seen The Piano?
No.
Okay, and I don't think a lot of people would even know that a woman directed that, and that it's Jane, and her name's Jane Campion,
and she wrote it too. And yeah, I mean, and I think that I'm only really interested in it because I'm a screenwriter, and I love her writing. But you're right, if that's not your area of interest, I don't know how many people are all that familiar with it anymore.
And
know?
She was one of the five Jane Campion to be get a Best Director nomination.
Yes.
Unfortunately, didn't win. Number two is Cleo from 5 to 7 by Agnes Varda, the great Agnes Varda. Yes. Number two is Janaine Dillman by Chantal Ackerman. Mm. Okay, so far I'm at Jane Campion, Agnes Varda, Chantal Ackerman. And then one of my favorites is Claire Denis. Mm. She's a French filmmaker, and she did Beau Travail.
Mm.
And so these are names that are the top 100. I just read the top three, and nobody on the street would even know who these people are.
Like Steven Spielberg and George Lucas. And
And is there any films in particular, Emily, that rang true to you that you think that were directed by women? Or like you said, Shirkers? And
yeah, I mean, Greta Gerwig's Lady Bird, I absolutely love. I have not seen Little Women yet, so I can't compare it. But Lady Bird was... fantastic. I didn't even know that was directed by a woman until after I watched it. And I was like, kind of makes sense. Definitely the way just the main characters portrayed and everything. It was brilliant.
You know, as a younger person interested in film, is there anything that you think that we need to do to promote female filmmakers, or what can we do to do that? Particularly, like, is there anything like, can we use social media or, you know, does Emily need to go make a film, or how do you think we should get this problem solved? Or
I think a main thing that Erin said was about the environment and just making that a little less macho in a way. I've been in a lot of environments and you can kind of get drowned out. And so I've had to speak up, but that's hard for a lot of women. And our femininity and stuff. So, I mean, it varies upon each woman, but I think just more, just allowing the opportunity for women to be in all aspects of filmmaking and just showing that, hey, we're here, you know, and it's cool.
I know. Well, it's like, I think what the reverse effect I have, everybody is really, you know, they're, it's controversy that Greta Gerwig didn't get nominated. She did for Lady Bird. But again, they're, she kind of gets all the press now. And then I wanted to just bring up some other women, like who's the woman that did The Farewell?
Lulu Wang Wong.
Yeah, she's amazing. Yeah, and she's people should see that movie. But what kills me is that 51% of the population are women. Mm-hmm. And the numbers just don't ring true to me. And I think I see it slowly happening with younger filmmakers, Emily, to stop this kind of I'm too afraid and to speak out, because I know of a lot of female filmmakers here in town that are doing some amazing stuff. So let's get into also about the Oscars and just a little bit more about that, how it seems kind of like a little too cachet, but it's a big deal when a woman gets nominated for an Oscar or wins, when Catherine Bigelow won. Off the top of your head, is there another film last year that you think that got robbed that maybe a female filmmaker did? Or
anybody?
I know.
Can't think of one either. I know. You know, and it's interesting because, like Emily was talking about, you know, women speaking up in filmmaking roles. I wonder if that's why a lot of women prefer to make their own private projects, right?
Yeah,
like
I can
like
see that.
Documentaries, experimental films, because they get to take ownership over the production, the directing, the screenwriting, all of those details, and they don't have to worry about speaking up over the sound of men.
You know? Well, and I know Greta Gerwig with Little Women, she was just supposed to be the writer in the beginning, and she she's like, no, I'm also going to direct it. Mm-hmm. And it took her a lot of tries. They're like, okay, you can direct it too.
Oh, that's great.
So she was actually just going to be the writer.
And
she kind of stuck up.
That movie being made by a woman, like of all movies, like that one, more than anything, Little Women should be directed by a woman.
and what's some local, you said you did some local things. Have you done anything local with women filmmakers or done some lectures or anything, Erin?
Yeah, I've submitted some screenplays to the Kansas City Women in Film and Television competition with the Kansas City Film Festival.
Yes.
I did that a couple of years. The last year, I won the Best Heartland Award, and it was fantastic. I mean, it's such an amazing experience because you have to be a woman filmmaker, woman writer to submit a screenplay. It's a short screenplay contest, so it's totally doable, you know, even for those, you know, viewers that may have never written a screenplay before. It's a short screenplay under 20 pages. And what's cool about it is that if you're one of the finalists, they, during the Kansas City Film Festival, they read your screenplay aloud with local actors.
Oh, wow.
And it was
a live reading.
Treasure,
Erin,
to listen to my words performed by these amazing actors. It was amazing. So, you know, if anybody is interested in getting into film making, I think that is a great opportunity. It's so possible.
Well, guess who wrote a screenplay that she hasn't put out that I told her I wanted her to print out and see? Is this amazing woman sitting next to you, Emily? It was a short for your class, right? Tell me a little bit about that.
You just asked me about this yesterday.
I know.
I still have to find.
I know.
This.
You gotta find.
It was for an online class, and I had to write a screenplay. I'd never done it before, but I was getting passionate during it, and so. I'm trying to remember the exact plot, but I just know it's about a refugee who worked in a laundromat, kind of in the northeast side of Kansas City. And there was another girl who had lived there for a while, and they became, you know, got this friendship going. And I don't know. I can't remember what happened after that. But
well,
I'll read it.
This, we're gonna
and then you're
going to
direct
out.
It, right?
Well, here's the deal. She is so super talented. I want her voice heard. So we're going to work on that screenplay.
Okay, but cool.
Okay, so enough for the topic of the day. Our next thing is we're going to talk about new releases. And I'm going to start first, okay? And this is called For Sama from 2019.
Sama. Sama. I'm going to tell film mechanic.
For Sama was directed by Wad Al-Khatib and Edward Watts, and it's a documentary about a woman in Syria that's a nurse, during the revolution. So against the Assad regime. She works at a hospital and she's really passionate about the revolution. And she finds her husband, who's a doctor. They get married and they have a daughter named Sama. But Sama is being brought up in this war toward hell on earth. And she documents the whole journey for a love letter to her daughter. And the whole movie is her as a voiceover, her talking to her daughter, hoping that when she's younger, that she will understand why this is all happening to her. Because the conflict that Awad al-Khatib has, it's like, do I stay in Syria and fight for this revolution, or do I get out of here to help my daughter? And it's war seen through a female perspective. And I've never seen anything like it. It's nominated for Best Documentary this year. It's one of the nominated. And it's just, it's brutal, but it's also a lot about love and passion. And but just to see war through a woman's eyes, I super, super highly recommend it. And it's streaming on Frontline. It's a Frontline production for PBS. And you can just go straight to Frontline's website and watch it. And again, it's for Sama, and it's amazing. It's directed by Awad al-Khatib, this woman that's giving this love letter to her daughter. So I really highly recommend that. So, okay, Erin, what's yours? I know this one. I want to hear what you have to say about this one. So
I selected Midsommar.
How long have you two been together?
Just over 3.5 years.
4 years.
Really?
Yeah.
It's Ari Aster's film, kind of follow-up to Hereditary. So if you've seen Hereditary, if you enjoyed Hereditary, Midsommar just turns up the volume. I mean, it really does. The things that I really love about Aster's directing is that he has this amazing ability to make these very passionate but authentic and quiet scenes between people just having conflict. Right. Just, you know, just normal conflict, so relatable. Right. And I think that that's what makes the inevitable horror that much more menacing, because here I am sitting, you know, watching this couple and who have this terrible breakdown in their relationship. Stunning performance by Florence Pugh, I think. Yes. It's heartbreaking, but it's very quiet and this camera is stationary, basically unmoving as we watch these actors play out this kind of devastating heartbreak. And then they go to this Midsommar celebration in Sweden. And it is all about this sort of drug-induced fever dream. And if you know anything about Aster, you know that it's going to be graphic. It's going to be very violent. Mm-hmm. In the same way that he doesn't look away from human conflict, mm-hmm. he doesn't look away from violence mm-hmm. and gore. And so there's like a perverse pleasure in that. And I have to say, at the end of the film, it is completely cathartic. I was disturbed by it in the same way that I was disturbed by Hereditary, mm-hmm. Maybe in a different way too, because I feel like the images were more terrorizing, I think.
Yes.
At the same time, it's aesthetically gorgeous. Yes. And he, I think, has a true passion for his characters. I think that he truly cares about them. And I think that there's empathy and sadness in a way that, some filmmakers that do horror genre or, you know, thrillers and these types of things maybe don't. And I think that that's really the thing that sets his filmmaking apart from others.
I cannot wait to see what this guy does next.
I can't either. I can't either.
Completely blown away.
I know. I feel like he's so young and the world is his oyster, right?
Yeah, he's one of my faves. Yeah, that's a great one. So, Emily, what's yours? What do you got for us?
Jojo Rabbit.
Today you boys will be involved in such activities as war games, ambush techniques, and blowing stuff up.
I don't think I can do this.
Was? Of course you can.
It's nominated for Best Picture, actually. I don't think it will win, but I also think the Oscars are rigged. So
exactly.
Anyways, but it is a movie that is kind of through the eyes of like a German boy.
It's time to burn some books. Yeah!
Growing up too fast. 10-year-olds shouldn't be celebrating war and talking politics.
I was thinking about World War II movies today, and I was like, yeah, most of them are from the American kind of point of view. So it's very interesting to have it be from a German point of view, and especially a young kid who doesn't know the whole picture, you know, and he has an imaginary friend, Hitler, and it just goes for a crazy ride, you know, moments I'm crying and I'm laughing, you know,
right.
It's just towing that line so beautiful, like beautifully, that Taika Waititi just really does. And he acts in it as Hitler because he said, I don't think anyone can do it the way I'm wanting it to be portrayed.
So, I know, it's crazy that he pulls this off. Right?
I know.
I love him.
And the dariness of it. So
yeah.
But some people, I mean, don't like it because they think it's too touchy. But I think that's what makes it an art film. I mean, you have to be edgy. You have to kind of carry that line. And yeah, I just think he does it really well.
Yeah, both Astor and him, they're taking chances, and we all love that, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so next, it's Stream House. So in the art house is the Stream House. Trying to be hip and cool here. I think I'm failing miserably. But so we're going to pick some movies that are on some streaming platforms, some deep dives, not just, like I said, not just Amazon or Netflix, but things like Criterion Collection and Canopy. And it's Canopy with a K. And if you have a Kansas City Library card, you can put that in there and you can watch all these amazing films on Canopy for free. Okay, so mine is You Were Never Really Here from 2017, directed by Lynn Ramsey.
I'm going to ask you some questions. How many are there?
One guy inside the front door, second guy on the top floor.
Okay, it stars Joaquin Phoenix, and he is a veteran from the war that has PTSD, and he has this, he's kind of hired to find missing girls.
Get up, can you hear me? My name is Joe. It's okay, come here.
And then it has this amazing plot twist. It's brutal. It's a gut punch. It's like, it's totally not recommended for everybody. And also, if you think Joaquin Phoenix was great in The Joker, or Joker, he's much more amazing in this, I think. But the reason I brought it up is Lynn Ramsey, because Lynn Ramsey is making a movie that everybody would think is directed by a man, and it's not. So all the tropes that you think that, oh, that this is, you know, you can tell this is directed by a woman, this is proving the fact that a woman can direct any kind of genre. And I highly recommend go watch all her movies. Of the top 100 greatest of women's films of all time, all four of hers were in there. So Lynn Ramsey, You Were Never Really Here from 2017 with Joaquin Phoenix. So check that one out, and you can stream that on Amazon Prime. Okay, Erin, what's your stream, man? What's your stream one?
So my suggestion for streaming, if you're interested in something different, Pioneers First Women Filmmakers is a Netflix series. It's presented it's all of these silent films. Like I mentioned before the masculine machine of Hollywood, women were writing, directing, and producing their own feature-length silent films. And this is a series of I think 17 films. It presented, they're beautiful in these like 2K and 4K restorations, all new orchestration for all scores for each one of them, and they're gorgeous. And they're so obviously, like, they're the obvious one, you know, filmmakers, Alice Guy Blanchet, Lois Weber, Dorothy Davenport, but there's a filmmaker named Marion E. Wong, who I'd never heard of before, but she does a film called The Curse of Quan Guan, 1916 film, made by her production studio, the Mandarin Film Company. There are only two reels left that survived out of an estimated 7 or 8 reels, and it's the earliest known Chinese-American film.
Oh, wow.
When she was making these movies, she had this dream that this would be, you know, the entrance to Chinese and American film, and it's gorgeous. But the one that really shocked me was Where Are My Children?, written and directed by Lois Weber. It details the life of a district attorney prosecuting an abortion doctor.
What?
And I cannot believe that they were able to touch on that subject, you know, in 1916.
Wow.
And that's what this series is all about.
Wow.
It's astonishing what women were able to do.
And where do we see this on?
Netflix. It's a Netflix series. So, it's streaming right now.
Okay.
Check it out.
Great. Wow, Erin, that's awesome.
Yeah.
I can't wait to see that.
Totally.
Okay,
yes.
So Emily, I know yours and I love this movie. Tell me about yours.
Yeah, so mine's also on Netflix. So everyone has Netflix
exactly.
Pretty much, so this is perfect. But it's called Shirkers.
When I was 18,
The thing I wanted more than anything was to make a movie.
By Sandy Tan. I actually saw it first in Erin's class documentary, wow. So thank you.
Yes. Nice.
I saw a lot of great documentaries in that class. So, but yeah, I just always keep thinking about it because it was just so complex and incredible. And it is kind of relevant to our topic that we've been talking about because, you know, she makes this incredible film and it's kind of French New Wave. And then that, the guy in that film ends up, you know, stealing.
The director.
Right. Well, she's the director of the film.
It's like a film about a film.
Right. It's kind of hard to talk about, but yeah.
So when she goes over to, is it Japan or
Thailand?
Thailand to make it.
So she lives there. And,
right.
Yeah, so she puts all of her savings and all of her family gets involved, and this guy kind of helps them make it, and he's from America, and he ends up taking the footage, and they mysteriously get it back, and it's this weird story, you know, and you kind of get to see some of it, but she never got to make the film.
Wow.
Because of that happening, and it could have been, she could have been one of these, you know, filmmakers we're talking about today. So it's just crazy to me.
So I hope that we've let you know about some incredible female filmmakers, what we can do to get the word out. And I'm so glad to have the two of you on the show. Erin, thank you so much for being on.
Thank you for having me. This was great.
Oh, great. And Emily, you rock. I love having you on the show. Thank you for being here.
Thanks.
Okay, well, that's Art House, a Flatland conversation about all things art cinema. But I want you to do me one favor if you can. Please just go out and see a movie. Thanks for joining us.